So last time we started the new technique for getting the control parameter that will give you some control output. That is the next technique is Cohen-Kuhn rule, and this method was proposed by the Cohen-Kuhn 1953. So we are basically we are doing the things that is. In practice, quite early, so in 1953, and is often used as an alternate method to the general method. So this method is similar to the general method, and in this basically we also use the open loop method, and the control action we can say in open loop means we are just removing the control action, and we are giving some input to the final control element. So open loop transient is induced by the step change in the signal to the valve. So we are introducing the input as a step change, and let's see how the system works. So this is a diagram. Now here you can see the figure for the typical control loop in which the control action is removed and the loop opened for the purpose of introducing the step change. That is basically of some strength, let's say M. So magnitude is M. So this is M by S to the valve. Generally, we have the unit step, so means 1 by S. But here we have the magnitude can be any, so that is M by S. The step response is recorded at the output of the measuring element, and the step change to the valve is conveniently provided by the output from the controller, which is manually moved. So basically, we are operating, as I told you, we are operating in two ways. One is auto mode, the other one is a manual mode. So once we have the control parameter in terms of auto mode, now we shift it. We remove the controller, and now we just given some disturbance, we can say as a step input, and then we are looking for the we are doing a manual mode, and we can see the parameter. The response of the system, including valve, process, measuring element, is called process action curve, and that is basically is a S shape. So after we present the Cohen-Kuhn method of the tuning, the basis of recommendation will be discussed, and the Cohen-Kuhn method is summarized by the following steps. So what are these steps? We have basically four steps. One is, first one is, so once the when you given the let's say step input, your response will recorded like a this shape. This is a S shape. So the, after the process reaches the steady state level, normal level of the operation, switch the controller to the manual mode as we discussed. So in a modern controller, the controller output will remain the same valve after switching as it had before switching. So basically, when we switch the mode from auto to normal mode, generally we in a earlier controller it gives some kind of bump, but here you can say this is a bumpless response. So we are not looking any spikes or something. So this is a because of modern controller. So with the controller in the manual, introduce a small step change in the controller output that goes to the valve and records the transient, which is the process reaction curve. So we have this reaction curve. So draw a straight line tangent to the curve at the point of inflection. The intersection of the tangent line and the time axis is apparent transport lag. This is known as the tau d. So we are just drawing the tangent to the intersection of, you can say, or you can say also this is a line of transient. Here we have written, yeah, record the transient. So this is a line of, you can say, where we have the change, so line of transient, and we draw a tangent on the transient, and where it cuts to the x-axis, this is known as the time lag. Okay, the apparent first order time constant is obtained by this. So we can also get the first order time constant, that is basically given by the relation, that is du by t equal to s, where t is time constant. So once you know the du value, right, this is ultimate final value, this by t is basically a slope, s is a slope, so that will we can find out the time constant or t value. So tau td as a lag time or lag time, and tau, this is a time constant, we can get from the graph by just plotting the tangent. So what is a du? That is basically, you can say, ultimate value of the b at the last time, and s is the slope of the tangent line, the steady state gain. B to m in figure, you can say, this is given by the relation kt, this is the ultimate gain, this is du by m, right? So you know the du and you know the m, we can get the kt value. So you know the kt value. So now basically we are getting the three parameters. One is kt, and t is basically time constant, and td, this is dead time. So after knowing the three parameters, we can get some guess about the, or you can say you have the initial guess about the controller setting. So the important point, attempt to the model process reaction curve by method shown in figure is good and does not give very good fit. This method will not give you good fit, but at least finding the point of inflection and drawing a tangent line at this point are quite difficult, especially if the data of the process reaction curve are not accurate and if they are very scattered. So in that case, this is not good practice to easily draw a tangent and all that and all these things. But this method, this is a drawback, but at least this method give you some guidelines about the initial guess. After that, you can do the tuning. So fourth point is basically using this KP, T and tau D from the step 3, the controller settings are found from the relation given in the table. So that is a relation for the proportional PI, PD and PID. Here, this, the settings are given for PD also, but in the Jordan method, there was nothing given for the PD. So all the controller settings are function of the dimensionless group TD by T. Here, the TD by T is basically comes as a dimensionless form. So you can say all the relations are given to the dimensionless form, that is TD by T. The ratio of the apparent transport leg to the apparent time constant. Also, KC is inversely proportional to KP. The KP we define here is basically inversely proportional to KC. Right? Their computation required that the response have 1 by 4 decay ratio. So once you find out all the values, if we are getting after the computation, after calculation, if we are getting the decay ratio 1 by 4, minimum offset, minimum area under the load response curve, and the other favorable properties, you can say your system is, your whatever the initial guess you are getting, this is a, it will give you the controlled output. A better method for fitting the processation curve is the first order transportation lag with the model is to perform least square fit the data. So as we are getting the S-shaped curve, processation curve, we can also correlate this curve with a first order system time lag. So once so whatever the S-shaped curve we are getting, if we find out the mathematical model for this S-shaped curve, that is, it is showing very good fit with the first order system with a some time lag, and if you fit the data, you will get very good result. So let's say if I define for the process GT is this is for transportation lag e to the power minus tau ds, and this is kp upon tau s plus 1, this is yeah, ts plus 1, this is basically first order system. So we tried this function to fit s-shaped curve, and it is showing very good result. It is almost giving the same type of behavior. So that is perform a least square fit to the data, that is numerical method we use, and it is showing good result. So some computers software such as loop pro package, this is available in the controlstation.com, provide an easy means to performing the fitting process, so that you can also try. You can see in the website, this is a control station, and that they use the package or loop tool, and they are trying to fit the data. So this is given there. So the rationale for the CC tuning method design with the representation of the S-shaped process station curve by the first order with the transportation lag mode is given by this type of function. To understand the basis for the graphical procedure, consider the response of the first order function of the equation to step change in the input. So here, we given as some step change, it is like this, of strength M, and you are getting a final output that is of this form, right? And we draw a tangent to the system, we get something like this, right? So after t equal to tau d, the response is a first order response. So it is started after time t d, which is a translation lag, and after that it is a first order system. The point of inflection of the curve at t equal to tau d and the slope of the tangent line at this relation is given by the time constant by this. So we draw a tangent at time t equal to t d, and we got this kind of. So tau d, basically already we have defined it. So there in the previous graph you can see that where the slope meet to the time axis, x-axis, that is td. Here we started itself from this point, so the property of td is same, or definition of td is same. This is where we have started reading the response of the output, so that is a td. And the slope of this tangent as defined is s equal to du by t, so that is given by the same relation. Okay, so first order system also, we represent the first order system with the same property. So you can use, instead of process relation curve, you can use a first order system with a dead time. Okay, it is showing the same behavior. So for the controller system shown in the figure, you can say you can determine the controller setting for a PI controller using the Jaren method and Cohen-Kuhn method. This is example. In this problem, the process reaction curve must be modeled by the method shown in figure, earlier figure. So we can try with the that time also. So here you can say that is a PI, so means the GC is given by this, and we have a unit step in. And we have the process or final control element, all these things that is given by 1 upon 1 plus s to the power 4. So we can say s to the power 4 means you can say this is a time domain of a e to the power. We have some first order, we have some s means it is some t to the power cube something, right? And we have dead time, so that's why this is also taken as Tt. Tt is given here as you can say 1 upon s. We have 1 upon s input and this process. So when you take that output in terms of transient, it will be like this. So transient is response is given. So here that is given in terms of s domain. We convert it to transient. This is 1 upon s into 1 upon s plus 2 or 4. So Tt will be this. And if you take the time domain form, it will be, or Laplace transform, inverse Laplace transform, it will be, Ct will be given by this. So you know the output response as a function of time, right? So now here you can find out by the mathematical way, where we are getting the, you can say, inflection point and all these things. So for that, what you can do? You can take the, make your first derivative to zero. So when you make the first derivative of this function, and it will be this, and if this is zero means this is at, it will be zero at t equal to zero. And if you take the second derivative means where the function has a maximum or minimum. So if you check this, you solve it, it comes out. You can say this is the time t equal to 3. So here you can say the location of the inflection point on the transient ct obtained by the setting the second derivative 0. So if you just make this second derivative 0, the point of inflection will find at, if you solve this, either t equal to 0 or t equal to 3, right? So if you solve mathematically, you will get this, the location of the inflection point, this is at 0, so it is giving you the time, that is t equal to 3. So knowing the point of inflection occurs at t equal to 3, you can compute the slope of the tangent line through this point. So if you just draw it from point t equal to 3, this will give you the point of inflection, and that will give you the sum value. It may be around 0.33, right? So you know the two points. You know the two points. One is tau d, td, and other one is 3. Similarly, for this is 0, and for this is 0.33. So you know the two points. You can easily calculate the slope. So here, what is the s value? The slope value, this is basically at time dt by dt, at time t equal to 3, this comes out 0.224. So you know the slope value also, right? How we are calculating slope? Just by the derivative. So derivative of the function, that will give you the slope value, 0.224. And how you get the point of inflection, just taking the second derivative 0, and that will give you t equal to 3. So for the expression, we obtain the value t at inflection point, that is t at 3, 3.53, and the value of t tangent line intersect the time axis from the slope. Thus, you can see, yes, the slope value is 0.224. So, by the reverse calculation also, you can get, once you know the slope value, you can get the td value, or you can directly read the td from graph. There is no problem, right? So here mathematically they calculated the TD value by knowing the slope value. This is 0.224, so you can calculate the TD value. It comes out 1.42. And the T value is basically BU by S, where BU is a 1, and this is a, because it's given the ultimate, they given the step input, so 1 by S, so that's why this BU is equal to 1, so this is 1 upon 2.224, that is 4.46. So by doing the yes,
doubt, any doubt? हाँ कोई डाउट है बताओ
सर. आवाज कट रही है सर.
आवाज कट रही है, वो तो बेटा नेटवर्क इशू हो सकता है. चलो मेरे ख्याल से और क्लियर आनी चाहिए अब. सो बेसिकली वी कैलकुलेटेड द टी टी डी S value, right? So, and corresponding, we can also calculate the KP, that KC value, that is basically KP value. KP value, that is the KP value was given as, yes, this was given as, yeah, BU upon M. So this is 1, right? BU 1, M 1. So that's why KP is 1. So KP value also 1. So now from the table, you can calculate, this is table. So from the table, now you can get for PI. So you have to take the PI controller. Now the T, tau D, T, TD, and KP all are known. Now you can substitute and you can find out KC, tau Y, all these information from this table. So KC and tau Y can be calculated, right? And if you see the graph of this function, it is showing that this is unstable kind of function, So transient for this setting that was obtained by the simulation is shown curve CC1. CC1, you can say CC1, this is the bigger oscillations. So it is showing CC1 type of graph, and this is, to our surprise, it is unstable. Even we are calculating by the table method. So means it is giving some initial guess of the data. So means you have to do some fine tuning also. Now, so that's why these examples are given. Even we calculated the things from the table, and we are not getting a controlled output. So that's why this is, I highlighted this. We are getting some unstable kind of thing. Even I will show you the CC2 graph. It is very fine controlled, right? And we have the ZN that is also very controlled. But ZN is a dotted line, you can see. So we have some control output, but this setting is showing some unstable, uncontrolled. So now a ZN method already we have applied, and we obtained for the following result, like KCU value 4, PU value 2 pi, KC 1.8, tau equal to 5.23. So you can see we have the difference in the values. KC is 2.9, here we have 1.8. Tau is 2.86. Now ZN method we are getting 5.23. So means by the different method, there is a huge difference in the setting. So that will lead to some unexpected results. So we try with a different method, and if you are getting a similar kind of result, then we are sure about the output. So mathematically we have to try with the 2-3 method, and then it is all are showing the same, then we can try for the practical aspects. The transient for this set of the controller parameters is also shown in figure. So we see that the response is stable and well damped. The lesson learned in this example is that the application of the tuning method may not produce a satisfactory transient, right? Fine tuning for this is important line. Fine tuning of these first guesses is usually needed. So means whatever you are getting result by the calculation, this is basically, it also requires fine tuning. Just like they summarize all the results for a given this kind of output, let's say ZN method, so KC, tau y, and the error method, we have the three error method, they are all given the KC, tau y values by the ZN method, by CC method, right? By the CC, that is basically a first order system with the dead time. We tried that also. So this is some, you can say, some approximation of the curve. And minimum ITA method, minimum IA method, right? So they are showing some parameters. You can see the difference of the parameter. We can see the huge difference in the parameters, just like KC value 1.8, but in CC it is 2.91. This is first order system 1.38. So that kind of differences we have, right? And you can see, just like ITAE. So here you are getting a different, let's say, different values of ITAE, right? So here what you do, you will just take, we have three values. So which is the minimum one? So that you have to take. You are doing you are putting the values, and you are looking for the parameter. Which one is showing the minimum that you will select, right? Just like a 19.37, the minimum, we will take this. Here we have 2.96, 2.79. So which is one is the minimum, 2.79. Similarly for the last case also. So we can see we are getting almost a control output. So basically, in a nutshell, what we are trying to say that we have a different method, and method can be even a direct method, or we can have a mathematical model that will represent the similar type of arrangement. And that will give you some kind of initial guess output. initial guess for the parameter. And once you know the initial guess of the parameter, you have to apply some fine tuning, and that will lead to the final control output. Right? This is the overall summary of the lesson. Now, this is basically, you can talk about, we can talk about some type of final control element. This is a control valve. Already we have discussed this kind of control valve earlier, but now I am going in much detail and some mathematical aspects. In earlier, we just introduced, we have the this kind of control valve is used, but now you can see the different parts of the control valve. We have, you know, the final control element that we generally use, a control valve. This is a pneumatic type of, yes?
Please size iska bada lijiye sir, slide ka.
Size bada de, okay. Theek hai?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically, we have a different type of control valve. This is basically a pneumatic control valve. Pneumatic means it is works with the air pressure. So we have a pneumatic, we have a hydraulic. So we have different type of valve. Hydraulic means it is works is based on the fluid pressure. Pneumatic means it is based on the, or fundamentals working is based on the air pressure. So here the air signal or air pressure that come to the diaphragm. This is diaphragm, and diaphragm, this is attached with a stem. This is written stem, and here we have some spring to just fix the stem or attach to the stem to the diaphragm. So as the diaphragm, as we apply the pressure, the diaphragm push the stem down, and we have the plug. At the last end, we have the plug, and the plug basically we have this kind of arrangement, right? And this is just, you can say, some orifice kind of arrangement. So we, depending upon the shape of the plug, it when it come down, it can block the path. And you can see in the other figure, if we have just inverted plug, it will come down, it will open the path. So we have you can say, depending upon the shape of the plug, we have air to open valve or air to close valve. Here if we insert the air, it will go down and it will close. So that's why this is known as air to close valve. Here if the pressure insert, the stem get down and the path will open. So that is, this is known as air to open valve. So depending upon the requirement, we will choose a particular type of plug, air to open or air to close. Here also we have maybe a two path. Maybe it is just it can be close to this end, so it will open from only slightly open from this end, and if this is in center, so it will open from the both the end. So basically it control the discharge, right? It control the discharge. Very fine controlled. Here we can say we have a bulk flow. Even in some type of graph that I will read later, but you can just look the picture first. Even sometime if you want very you can say just like a leak proof kind of flow, so in that case we have two plug attached with the same stem. And two plug means you can see when the stem will go down, one is closing the path and other one is, both can close the path. Both here in this case it is both are closing the path. Both are closing the path means this is a tight you can say tight close, right? There is no leak. It may be we can have a plug in pairs, like one is closing the path, other one is opening the path. It means even maybe this is a possibility that both are closing, but one is closing earlier and other one is not that much tight. right? Depending upon the position. So means there is always leak. Flow is coming from this, and let's say the stem position is down. So this path is totally leak proof, but here there is a small gap. It can be also possible. So there is a leak also. So generally, in a bulk kind of flow, we can also tolerate with the leak. So we use that kind of lock valve. And so now, depending upon the figure, depending upon the structure of the final control element, we use different kind of pneumatic valve. So the valve shown in the figure is a single seated. Here you can see this is a single seated valve, meaning that the valve contains one plug with one seating surface, right? For a single seated valve, the plug must open against a full pressure drop across the valve. So there is a full pressure drop. So means once there is a full pressure, then it will open or close. If the pressure drop is large, this means that the larger, more expensive actuator is needed. Means this kind of the surface. So when it is opening with the high pressure, it means the strength of the material should be very high. So that's why it increases the cost. So more expensive actuator needed. To overcome this problem, valve are also constructed with the double seating with a shown in figure. Double seating, this is a double seating. This is a double seating valve. So in that case, low cost actuator is required, or you can say the pressure drop is not so high. So that's why we can use the double seated actuator. So in this type valve, two plugs are attached to the valve stem and each one has a seat. So this is also, it also contains a seat. So it means the pressure drop is not so much high, right? So the construction wise, we can say the for the control valve shown in figure, an increase in the signal pressure above the diaphragm exert a force on the diaphragm and the back plate, which cause the stem to move down, right? So that function you can easily understand. When the pressure exert, the stem go down, right? The stem has to go down in all the cases. Okay, so this causes the cross-section area of the flow between the plug and the seat to decrease, thereby reducing or throttling the flow. Such valve action shown in figure is called air to close. When we have a reducing in flow or throttling in a flow, that is known as the air to close. And reverse action air to open can be accomplished by designing the actuator so that the pressure is applied to the underside of the diaphragm, and for which case an increase in the pressure to valve raise the stem, right? So maybe you can also design like this. We are applying the pressure from the other end like this, right? That maybe here we are applying the pressure from top. We can also give the pressure from bottom or from the side. So it will move the diaphragm up. So the same thing can be used as air to open kind of arrangement. So an alternate method to reverse a valve action is to leave the actuator as shown in figure and invert the plug on the stem and place it under the valve seat. So the similar arrangement you can make on your choice. In general, selection of the type of AO or AC is made based on the safety consideration. Already I have told you the example in earlier. Let's say depending upon the flow in the process, we can use air to, let's say if you have a failure, so what condition you want? Let's say if you have a failure and we want the flow should be continue. So means in that case, you can use this kind of valve, right? Because when there is a failure, diaphragm will break and the stem will go down. Stem will go down means the path will flow. And what you want? You want in a failure mode, there is a flow in a process, then you have to use this kind of valve. If you want, no, there should be no flow in the process, you can use air to close type of valve. So that basically depend upon the safety consideration. Okay, so the flow pattern through the valve is designed so that the pressure drop across the seat A tend to open open the plug, and pressure drop across the seat B tends to close the plug. So that is basically you have this A and B. So we can design the double seated valve according to our requirement. It should, which one should open, which one should close. So we can use, or we can design like this. The counterbalancing of the force on the plug reduces the effort needed to open the valve, with the result of smaller, less expensive actuator is needed. Right. So basically, in a double-seated valve, it is difficult to have tight shutoff. Tight shutoff means leak-proof. It is very difficult to maintain that, because maybe one plug has tight closure. There is usually a small gap between the other plug and seat. For this reason, single-seated valve are recommended if you want to tight shutoff. In many processes, the valve is used throttling flow and is never expected to operate near to shutoff position. So that's why we can use double-seated valve in most of the process. For this condition, the fact that the valve is a small leakage at the shutoff does not create a problem. So we can use that kind of valve. Now, the main important part, and this you have in your lab also, the similar kind of calculation you have to do in your lab, control lab subject. When you do the control lab, you will do the similar, this same experiment in the lab also. Valve sizing. Valve sizing, basically, it is that they are basically, you can say, the flow rate and the pressure drop in the valve. That is the main parameter. And they are given basically by this relation, where Q equal to CV, FX, and delta P of valve, and SG. Right, SG is the specific gravity, that generally we take this as one. And FX is basically, you can say, the fraction of the maximum flow. This is a function, right? Fraction of the maximum flow, and CV is the factor associated with the capacity of the valve, right? Delta P, this is pressure drop across the valve, Q is the flow rate. So basically, this is a very simple equation that we, it will give the size of the valve. Equation applies to the flow of an accomplishable non-flashing fluid through the valve. It means the fluid will not vaporize by changing the pressure drop. So non-flashing fluid through the valve. Manufacturers rate the size of the valve in terms of factor CV. Sometimes CV is the defined as the flow of a fluid of a unit specific gravity. So the fully open valve across the pressure drop is of 1 psi. So it depends if you just take the specific gravity 1 and pressure drop is 1, and then the, what is the flow that is given as a CV. Fx is equal to 1, delta P 1, Sg 1. Then you can say whatever the pressure generated or whatever the CV value is given by the flow rate. So equation is based on the well-known Bernoulli equation determined by the pressure drop across the valve and the resistance, right? So from where we derive this, it is by the Bernoulli equation. So it is important to emphasize that CV must be shown since so many valves are used rated in terms of CV. CV in a equation, practical importance. However, some industries now we defining the valve coefficient, KV, defined by the equation. So in the industry, most of the, we do not give the value in terms of CV and FX. Generally, they combine all these factors and give a term that is in terms of KV. So how KV and CV are related? This is related by this, KV equal to 0.856 times CV. And we have the similar formula, but the KV and CV are related. So generally, manufacturers give value in terms of this KV. So manufacturers of the valve provide the brochure, nomograph, and computer program for sizing valve used with the gas एंड स्ट्रीम। नाउ फॉर ए स्लाइडिंग स्टेम एंड द प्लग टाइप ऑफ द कंट्रोल वॉल, वैल्यू ऑफ सी वी इज रफली इक्वल टू द स्क्वायर ऑफ द पाइप साइज, दिस इज मल्टीप्लाई बाई द 10। सो स्क्वायर ऑफ द पाइप साइज इज द सी वी वैल्यू जनरली, जस्ट लाइक इफ यू हैव ए 3 inch कंट्रोल वॉल, इट शुड हैव ए सी वी वैल्यू ऑफ अबाउट 90। इट मीन्स वॉट इज द 3 inch कंट्रोल वॉल एंड दिस इज अ पाइप साइज, सो वॉट इज द स्क्वायर ऑफ दैट, 3 का स्क्वायर, दैट इज 9, एंड इट विल मल्टीप्लाई बाई 10, सो दिस इज 90। सो सी वी वैल्यू इज अराउंड 90 विद द यूनिट करस्पॉन्ड टू दोस इक्वेशन। This implies the capacity of the fully open wall 90 gallon per minute with a pressure drop of 1 psi. So this is the physical meaning of the value. It will imply a capacity of fully open wall 90 gallon per minute with a pressure drop of 1 psi. So depending upon the capacity of the wall, we can depending upon the CV, we can define the capacity of the wall. So that is the wall sizing. So this is important aspects. You can choose a particular size of the wall. Now the wall characteristics. Wall characteristics means it is basically, you can say, a function of a control wall is to vary with the flow through the wall by means of change in the pressure to the wall top. When you change the pressure on the wall top, there is a change in the fluid flow. So the relation between the flow through the wall and the wall stem position or lift, generally we call this as a lift, how much this lift is called the wall characteristics, which can be conveniently described by the mean of a graph as shown figure. So here we have a fraction of the maximum flow and this is a fraction of maximum lift. So basically this is a Q and this is a lift in the stem position. Three types of characteristics are illustrated. We have now you can see what is this value, the y-axis. Y-axis basically, if you change the flow rate, first thing, let's say how much flow rate you can give, let's say Q max, there is some value Q max you can give through the wall. And what is you are supplying now, that let's say Q value. So F is basically Q upon Q max. So what fraction of the maximum flow? So that is basically given by the Q by Q max. And the fraction of the maximum lift, it means, let's say the wall can be fully open to fully close, how much the lift is total? Let's say 10 centimeter. What is the position here? 1 centimeter. So what is the fraction change? Fraction lift, that is 0.1. So we have that kind of table. So depending on the flow, you have a different type of lift, different value of the lift, and you can plot this. So you can get a result like this, a straight line. You can get a result like this, curve. You can get a result like this, lower curve. So first one is basically called as a linear. Second one is this is increasing sensitivity, or we call this as equal percentage wall. Second one is this one. So this is equal percentage wall. Third one, this is decreasing sensitivity, and this is known as the square root wall. So we have three names depending upon the nature of the curve. So you can see here, in general, the flow through the control wall for the specific fluid at the given temperature can be given by this function. Flow rate is given by F1, the wall stem position, P naught and P1 is the upstream and downstream pressure. So if let's say if we fix the pressure upstream downstream constant, right, fixed value of P0 and P1, so it will be only a function of stem position. Flow rate is a function of stem position, okay, or in other word, the flow is a function of wall stem position for the convenience. So you can say we are defining F equal to Q upon Q max, X equal to L by L max, that I have told you for the graph. This is, you can see F, this is Q by Q max, X is L by L max, right? This is the same thing. Okay, so यू कैन से एफ ऑफ एक्स बेसिकली व्हाट दिस इज एल बाई एल मैक्स दिस इज बी दिस विल बी क्यू बाई गिवन बाई क्यू बाई क्यू मैक्स तो दिस इज सम फंक्शन राइट हियर यू कैन सी वी डिफाइन द टर्म इंक्रीज सेंसिटिविटी डिक्रीज सेंसिटिविटी ओके वी विल हैव ए टेक्निकल टर्म बट हाउ वी आर डिफाइनिंग दिस दिस बेसिकली फर्स्ट लेट्स से फर्स्ट डिफाइन द सेंसिटिविटी sensitivity basically we define mathematically as df by dx df by dx means the f, we have a f versus x so the, whatever the slope we have that is defined as df by dx and if the slope is decreasing we can say decreasing sensitivity if slope is constant we can say linear sensitivity if slope is increasing we have the increasing sensitivity so here you can see for the third case your slope is decreasing so this is decreasing sensitivity and here the slope is increasing so you can say this is increasing sensitivity and this is only linear right so we have the three class of the sensitivity so wall characteristic curve can be obtained experimentally for any value of the measuring flow through the wall as a function of lift or wall top pressure under condition of a constant stream and downstream pressure so you just keep you can keep you know you have basically that we are not changing the pressure drop so when you perform this kind of experiment you have the arrangement you make the pressure drop constant and then you will see how by changing the flow rate how the stem position are changing so that you will plot and you will get this So wall characteristic curve can be obtained experimentally for any wall by measuring the flow through the wall as a function of lift or wall top pressure under condition constant upstream and downstream. So this is you can say a proper precaution we have to take. So two type of wall that are widely used: linear and equal percentage. Mostly in the practical aspects, we use these two kind of wall. Okay, so what is a linear? 5 minutes more, so we will at least pack up this topic. So linear wall is basically one of the wall for which the sensitivity is constant with relation between flow and lift is linear. It means your sensitivity is constant, so that's why you can say df by dx is constant. Let's say some value alpha, right? So this is known as the linear wall. So if you just integrate this, you will get this kind of integration. So you know this is a fraction, so it will vary from 0 to 1. Similarly, x is also fraction; it will vary from 0 to 1. So if you integrate it, you will get alpha equal to 1. So alpha equal to 1 means you have the when alpha equal to 1 means f is given by x. So this is a linear wall, right? Now the equal percentage wall, the second one. Equal percentage wall means you can see the diagram. Equal percentage wall means the second one, this one. So means you can say the slope is some function of you can say the slope df by dx is some function of f. Let's say beta. This is some relation, right? It is not constant. It's given by some relation. So beta is a constant. This is beta is a constant. This is a integration of this equation. If you just do the integration, you will get this kind of function, right? And you solve this, you will get this, where we are assume that at x equal to zero, your f equal to f naught. X equal to zero, this is f naught. We are saying this is not zero, right? Because if you just take this zero, it means your value will be infinite, so that's why we have to take some infinite. This is a mathematical consideration you have to do. At x equal to zero, this is not zero, right? Otherwise, when you integrate this, just like ln 1 upon f naught, right? So if f naught is zero, it means this value is infinite. So this is not mathematically correct. So that's why we take this practical case like there is some leakage from the wall, so that's why at this is not completely zero. So beta can be expressed in terms of f naught by inserting f equal to 1, x equal to 1. So x equal to 1, f equal to 1. So beta can be a function of, beta can be have a value of in terms of f naught. So that is given by this value, right? So you have now beta equal to 1 upon f naught. So you can substitute here. And if you just substitute means it will be 1 upon f naught to the power x like this, right? So you know this 1 upon f naught means we can also write this as f naught to the power minus x. And e to the power ln to power ln f naught minus x means this is f naught minus x. E ln, this is ln e. So this will cancel out. So we have only f naught to the power minus x. So we have like this. Or we can say f naught 1 minus x, right? So beta, we f equal to basically what we derive that this is f alpha to the power x minus 1, right? So this is x minus 1. And this is known as the equal percentage wall. This is known as the equal percentage wall, where alpha equal to 1 upon f naught. 1 upon f naught. So here you can say, acha chalo theek hai.